Hello, my name is Dan Kelly, and in this video, I'll show you how to use the OCE package in the computing language called R. OCE is on CRAN, so you can install it in the normal way. But I won't press enter because I don't want to do this. I have a more recent version installed. You can install it directly from GitHub, which is how many people do, especially people who want to stay on the cutting edge of new features and to help us in the development team to help us with debugging. So to start your session with OCE, you do this. Of course, you can put, there's another package called OCE data. You can put quotes around the OCE. So now we've loaded up, we have the namespace. I'd like to show you how to use OCE to work with CTD files, really the workhorse machine of oceanography, and CTD files stored in what's called CNV format. So let's see. This command will show us local files which end in .cnv. Now you could also go here and look in files and get a graphical interface, which in my case would show you probably several hundred files. I prefer just to type. So let's work with this one here. So the way you read it is to do read.oce and then give a file name d2, that completes. So what read.oce will do is to look within the file, look at the file name, and also look within the file and try to determine the file type. OCE can read dozens of different file types, different types of ADCP, different types of CTD, Landsat images, many, many different file types. So read.oce will figure out the file type and it will dispatch to another function, which will do the actual work. I happen to know the function name, but even I wouldn't bother with that. I'd use read.oce. This is going to read it into a local object, and I'll save that object into something called d for data, perhaps. So that's done. Now you could, I suppose, go into this environment thing and click on d and see what's in it. There are some metadata. Within the metadata, there are units. There are units for scan and pressure, depth, temperature, and so forth. It's quite a challenge to read through this list, and I don't view it as particularly informative. I almost never use that viewer thing, so I'm just going to minimize that. The way I would look at what's in the content would be to get a summary. So a summary of D. Summary is a generic function in R, and the OCE package has made a specialized version of it for each of maybe a dozen or more data types. So there's a specialized version for CTDs. So when I say summary, it's going to find out that D is a CTD object, and it's going to dispatch to that particular function. And it spits out a lot of stuff on the screen. It tells you it's a CTD to begin with. This is a particular kind of CTD that it is. I'm showing you serial numbers here, the file name from which it was read, the header file that was originally associated with this. You can see from the C colon that it was a Windows machine. The start time, you can see that the sampling interval is 1 decibar. These data are subsampled, averaged, and then decimated to 1 decibar. It's a standard oceanographic thing to do. There's the station number and the location and the water depth. And then it gives an overview of the data. It's in columns minimum, mean, max, and then the dimension. In this case, these are vectors, so it's a single number. If it were a matrix, it would be something slash across something, and so forth. This is the number of NA values, of which there are none in this data file. So this is sort of interesting here. On the left are the names as stored in the object. So it stores something called scan and something called pressure and depth. In square brackets are the units, and maybe specializations of the units as well. So look at the second row, pressure. But the original name for that pressure was PR, uppercase D, uppercase M. So what OCE is doing is it's saving the original names, but it's converting them into standard names so that all objects, for example, that have a pressure, we'll call it pressure, no matter what it was called in the original file. And just one more thing, you can see here that there are two temperatures, and on the right-hand side, you can see that they were T0 90C and T1 90C. These are just two different temperature recording devices, thermistors. And what RCE does when it detects multiple versions of something is it gives names with suffixes that are numeric. So temperature is the first one it read, temperature 2 is the second one. If there were a third one on this machine, it would be called temperature 3. A lot of different things on this, and you know, you might be interested in different things depending on what work you're doing. It's read all the data. It also has a processing log, and we haven't actually done any processing. We just created an object here. So, I told you that summary was a generic function, and so is plot. If you're familiar with R, you know that plot will do different things depending on what the object is. If it's a data frame, it might do a different thing than if it were a time series, for an example. I'll just do plot because the OCE package has overridden the generic plot. And in this case, it will say, well, gosh, that's a CTD object, and so I'll make certain type of graphs. And here we see the graph that it made. Over in the right-hand panel, it's made at the top row there two profiles, each of which is showing two data streams. This is the profile, this is the surface, and this is about 1,000 meters deep, and because a meter is about a decibar. And the water depth, like you can see here, the water depth is about 3,800 meters, so this goes down to 3,800 meters. That's how to read this graph. The red is temperature, the green is salinity, the next one on the right, the blue is sigma theta, that's a potential density anomaly, so-called. You have to add 1,000 to that to get the actual potential density. Here it would be 1,022. And in red or brown or whatever that color is, that is n squared, the square of the Brunt-Weissler frequency or the square of the buoyancy frequency, depending on your notation. And then this is showing potential temperature as a function of salinity. These vertical lines here are lines of constant potential temperature. This is 22, 23. This slashing line here is the freezing temperature. Gives you a clue that it's in a cold place, and it is, because you can see in the map here it's at latitudes of between 70 and 80. This is in the Beaufort Sea, as it turns out. Right, so you can plot individual things if you want. If you just want a temperature salinity plot, you can say plot TS of that object and it will produce that for you. If you want a profile, x type equals, what am I doing here? Salinity, and it will plot profile salinity. I could do salinity and temperature, which is what we had before actually. You could, and so forth. So you can look at different things within the object. It's a little bit about plotting. Now I'd like to talk a little bit about how you can extract data from the object. Let's say we want to look at the first few temperatures. We use head as a convenient way of looking at the first few anything. And I'll say D, and the notation is square bracket, quote, and then you name the thing that you're interested in. So for temperature, that would be, those are the first few temperatures. Another nice way of seeing that is to do the SDR, I call STR. And in fact, OCE has a thing called vector show. It's quite convenient. It makes a string, and it shows you the name of the thing that you're trying to show, and the first few values, and then ellipses, dot, 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 and the last few variables, and then the length. This is actually pretty handy, especially in programming, because while str gives you just the beginning, lots of times it's useful to see the end as well. Right, so that's a little bit about extracting data from inside an object. I want to talk about manipulating an object. Let's say we only want to look at the top 500 meters. So I'm going to say D top will be a subset of D for which pressure is less than 500, less than or equal to or something. Now, oceanographers always say, I said 500 meters, and then I typed in decimeters. Very common. It's pretty common for data sets not to even have depth. This one has depth, so I could have used depth, but I'm using pressure. So now I'll do a summary of D top. And you can see that the processing log has an extra item. So these were the two that were there before. And then we have this item that says that we made a subset. It's a feature of OCE that it records work that you've done on the object. And you can see these are timestamped, and you can see that I've been yammering at you for some nearly 10 minutes actually so far. Let's see, I could plot DTOP, and you'll see that it's, yeah, again, it's doing what we expected. We can focus a little more. So now people who are familiar with the Arctic will see all sorts of things that are very interesting in this data set, and I have to kind of restrain myself a little from getting intrigued by that. Physical oceanographers will look at this panel compared also with this panel, but I guess I just won't do that. So I'm going to bring this to an end. What I've showed you is how to start up OCE, how to find particular file type. Well, lots of times you know the data files you have anyway, but how to read something, how to summarize it, how to extract data from it, how to do subsets, and how to plot. In quite a lot of cases, simply reading and plotting is much of what you want to do. And so I hope that this was fairly useful for you. You can also string things together. D20. Okay, so that will do, it will read, and it's not saving into an object, it's just plotting. That can be kind of convenient when you're just playing around trying to find a data file. Great. Thanks for the attention. I'll maybe make some more videos on working with different data types or doing more sophisticated analysis. Bye-bye.